explains the sun, the yellow of the sun and the blue of the water create the green of vegetation. If you remove that blue, if you remove the water from the soil, the vegetation can't grow, the soil dries up, we create deserts. And we have expanding deserts in over 100 countries in the world. So when you read about certain countries, you're going to read that there's cyclical drought, and the strongest thing I can say to you this morning is that's not correct. We have parts of the world running out of water as we sit here this morning. India has 23 million bore wells going 24/7. They are coming to the end of their water in certain communities and even big cities like Mumbai, where they're coming to the bottom of the water table. Think of all the countries in the world. I'm most worried about India. Although they say Yemen is probably going to be the first country to literally run out. They're totally dependent on a small amount of groundwater, and they're planting cot trees. You know, they chew the cot as a narcotic and export it, and it's a very water-intensive plant or tree. All of the countries of the Middle East are in crisis. All of the Mediterranean and Greece, Italy, all of the southern European countries. 22 countries in Africa are in crisis. There are 677 major lakes in Africa. Every single one of them is in crisis or decline. Right now in Africa, one in three people don't have enough water to drink, don't have access to clean water. In 10 to 15 years, says the UN, that will be one in two. We're going exactly in the wrong direction. Africa is another place where we're going to see terrible grief around water crisis. Mexico City is sinking on itself. They've taken all their water from underneath. It's called subsidence, so it's just kind of sinking in on itself. Australia, country I've come to love and visit many times, they made themselves wealthy. It's a fabulous country. It's the most urbanized, sophisticated, well, the most urbanized country in the world, and one of the most sophisticated, I would argue. I mean, if you live in the big cities, you can just pretend that there's nothing wrong, but they made their whole economic model on siphoning off their only water source, the Murray Darling River, to grow cotton, to grow rice in the driest inhabited continent on Earth, to produce all the lovely wine that we all love, and then they disperse it all over the world. Now, this is called virtual water trade. And that's the water that you use to grow something or produce something that you then export out of your country. And this is a very, very big problem in our world because many, many countries are exporting away their precious water sources. I was in Kenya in East Africa last year, and I went out on a lake called Lake Naivasha, which is an exquisite lake, the site of the last wild hippopotamus herd in Africa, in East Africa. And the boatman, a great tall man, an older man from the community, a Maasai warrior, they tell me he had been, in an old wooden boat, he stood and paddled and pointed out things. And I looked at an island, and it had wildebeest and giraffes, and I said, oh, that looks just like out of Africa, the movie with Meryl Streep and Robert Redford. And he said, well, that would be because that's where Out of Africa was filmed, right there. I get to see Meryl Streep kind of watching for him coming in on his plane, or not, or maybe didn't. But the tragedy of this place is that this lake is surrounded by rose farms, a corporate rose farms from Europe, and all of the roses sold in England and the rest of Europe mostly come from Lake Naivasha. So you know what the big concern last 2 weeks ago, one of the big concerns was a big CNN story about what will the Europeans and the British do without roses when they have the volcano and the roses couldn't be flowing in. It was like, well, maybe the volcano will save Lake Naivasha. I was the only person who could see sort of something good coming from the volcano, right? Because it's going to be gone, they're pumping that water, and this is called importing your water footprint. So when you have a virtual water trade and you trade water out of your watersheds in your country, it goes somewhere else. And that country is importing its water footprint. Great Britain imports 2/3 of its water footprint, so as much as most of Europe. Japan imports most of its water footprint, Saudi Arabia, and so on. So if you don't have water and you're rich, you can buy it from other places. And then the latest thing is something called land grabs, where big investment companies and or countries, and in this case it's China, and I forgot to mention China and India, are going into Africa and buying up huge amounts of land and water just so they will own it in a future time when they run out of both. Okay, so this is going to affect the geopolitics of the world. And I should mention China, because China has about the same amount of water as Canada, but of course a much greater demand, but still enough if they took care of it for everybody. But what they're doing is, instead of leaving it in watersheds to grow food or whatever, they're siphoning it off to produce all the toys and running shoes for the world. And so they are massively exporting their water out of their country in the form of, you know, some of it plastic junk, and certainly a lot of it, containing toxics, so they just kind of get the toxic chain made there, sent over here and so on, sent back there for recycling and destruction. So this is this story of water is a very, very important one. And if I can make this point, because when you leave here, you'll think, okay, what are the two or three most important things? Really, this is a world running out of clean water. That is what I have to say to you this morning. And how do we get this way? Well, we have seen water as a tool, a resource for our wealth, our pleasure, our enjoyment, and our profit. We move it where we want, and we dump whatever toxins we want into it, and we grow whatever we want, however we want, wherever we want it. We do not stop and think it's the essential element of a living, breathing ecosystem. And if we don't take care of that living, breathing ecosystem, then it's going to come back and bite us, because, of course, we may think we're better than the animals, but we're a species like any other that's dependent on this ecosystem to live. So what we are, the work that